and welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, we're going to take a look at how Microsoft is transforming virtual desktop delivery by separating operating system, user profile, and app layers. Now, we're going to show you how we've improved the Microsoft Teams remoting experience with AV redirection and a preview of Windows Virtual Desktop Admin Portal and the things that you can do there. And I'm joined once again by Scott Manchester from the Windows Virtual Desktop team. So please give him a warm welcome.
Thanks. Thanks, Jeremy. It's really great to be back up here again with you.
All right. So one of my favorite topics, Windows Virtual Desktop. It's been generally available now since September, and it's our fully managed virtualization solution on Azure. So congrats for shipping that. It's only been a few weeks, but how's that going?
It's been going great. Hopefully, you and the audience have had a chance to go live with Windows Virtual Desktop. We've had thousands of new customers onboard onto the service in these last about 35 days, I think. Both using our native solution that we went live with and the Citrix WVD solution that also went live at GA.
Right, and I know there's been a ton of work that the team's really been focused on since you went GA. So what are some of the other things that you've been working on in those last couple of weeks?
Well, we've been very busy, Jeremy. We've been continuing to extend the capabilities of the service and expanding the partner program to bring more value and options to our customers. But some of the most significant work we've been doing is enhancements to the whole Windows experience itself. So we've been breaking down the Windows experience into the user data, the applications, and the OS layers. Now, on a physical device, these layers are intrinsically linked. And the user experience is consistent every time a user logs onto a machine. Their apps, their data, and their OS experience is deeply tied together. But in a virtualized environment, a brokering service typically routes a user to a virtual machine from a host pool. And that host pool is typically the one being routed to that can host the workloads, the apps and desktop workloads for that user.
Right.
But that could be a different machine every time that user logs in.
Right, so everybody knows the challenge, right? You have to make sure that you can create a virtualization environment that kind of mirrors or matches what you can do here
That's right.
A local physical device. You don't have to train people to save stuff to a Z drive or an I drive or something for their files. Just keep it in the documents folder or whatever they're used to using. Also, from an IT admin perspective, there's a lot of IT admins out here, I think. It's also hard to maintain those environments.
Yeah, exactly. So we've already provided a mechanism to give you that same experience with user data and settings by managing user profiles with FS Logic. Now, with FS Logic, we've separated out the user profile layer from the virtual machine. And the way we do that lets the users work in a way that feels natural. To the user, it feels like they're saving and accessing those files just as if it was a local disk. But in reality, that user data is hosted in a file share and mounted when the user logs into that machine. Now, that takes care of one of the three layers. Now, we've separated out the user data layer, but we still have the application layer and the OS still deeply tied together.
Right.
Now, in a shared or pooled virtual machine, this is a challenge because each user might need a different set of apps. And as we mentioned before, they can be assigned to a different VM every time they log in. So you're left with a couple options as an IT admin. You can either manage a bunch of unique VM pools, all customized with different users' roles. And these images would all need to be individually maintained and patched, and that creates a lot of overhead for the IT department.
Right, but it's still super common. A lot of people are doing this.
They are, indeed. But there's some better options now. So additionally, customers might also overload a single VM image with more apps than any single user would need, and then hide and show those apps based on policies.
But it's a mega single image, and the thing is the licensing stuff can get kind of tricky as well, depending on the apps that they've got.
So that's obviously you're dealing with a very bloated image, and then how do you deal with which users have the access rights and licenses to those different applications? So another tool people often use is to actually stream the apps dynamically.
Yep.
So you might stream those apps when the user logs in, but that takes a lot of effort to get the apps both set up in a streaming format and to build all the back-end streaming infrastructure that would be required to do that.
Right, so you have to repackage the apps, get them ready for virtualization and streaming. Then they still come into the OS itself, the VHD or VHDX file, and consume space, right? So that's all kind of challenging as well. And you got to wait for that file transfer to happen, and then even if it's streamed, for everything to be there before it can actually perk up and start working.
All of those have some kind of compromise, but there is a lot of tools and resources out there for customers.
All right, so how would you then solve for this? What have you done?
Well, what if the apps worked like the user profile data and were stored outside the virtual machine, and each app attached itself like we do the virtual disk of the user profile? And we did not have to repackage the apps, and this just worked naturally.
All right, so I think this has been something that people have been waiting for a long time. You've actually solved the problem of being able to decouple apps from the OS.
We absolutely have, and we call it MSIX App Attach. And you can start using this today if you're part of the Windows Insider program. This is coming in the next version of Windows, and you can use this with Windows Virtual Desktop. So like we did with the user profile, we've modified Windows so that apps can be stored off the Windows disk, and we just need to attach the apps to the VM on demand. Now, you can create app groups and assign different users to these, and these are available instantly when the user logs on, because you don't have to stream the app binaries. And to the user, it looks and feels the same as it does in their home PC and their desktop.
And the cool thing is the actual application payload is left off the machine. The OS image is left clean. It's left smaller than it would be. Now, I bet people want to see this. Can you show us what that would look like to do MSIX app attach?
Let's do that. So I'm going to show you guys the connected experience of using MSIX app attach and dynamically add OneNote to a managed desktop. So let me switch over here to one of my VMs I've already pre-connected to. And before I actually show you this, Jeremy, I want you to take note of the C drive over here and the amount of available space.
So 21.4 gigs today.
Yep. And I don't have this app installed, so I'm going to just show you that it's not here in my start menu yet.
No tricks up your sleeve.
Yep. And ultimately, this whole experience is going to be integrated into the WVD management experience. So it'll make it easy for you.
Just to be clear, the app will stay in another location, like in other words, like Azure Files or somewhere, and just attach itself as part of a virtual disk, but not move into the VM.
That's exactly right, in a highly optimized fashion as well.
OK, let's
take a look.
Yep.
So I'm going to run this script here. And again, this will be integrated into our experience ultimately directly. But I want to show you what this looks like. Now, as I mentioned, this application is about 1.2 gigabytes once it's installed on disk. So what's happening in the background is actually attaching the app, and then it's already launching it. And being that this is a large app, it takes a few seconds for this to load. But the performance of doing this using app attach is pretty much the same performance you'd get on bare metal. And in this case, not only am I loading the application, but we're actually done the composition of both the application and my user profile data. So you'll see when this app loads, it's actually going to load not only as a clean installation of OneNote, but
you're
also
signed in as Scott.
So signed in as Scott. All my data was already there available as well.
Very cool. But let's prove it. Go back to your File Explorer and make sure that we're still at 21.4.
So here we are with a 1.2 gigabyte application effectively loaded on this VM. And I haven't touched.
And you can even pull down the Explorer. We didn't do any games in terms of storage drive D. That's the C drive.
Yeah, that is the C drive. 21.4 gigabytes. Now imagine how this would play out over a large number of users.
Right. So by the way, if you're new to MSIX, these packages also work with Win32 apps. So you can actually package up your apps for Win32 into the UWP as MSIX files. But how does this differ then from a traditional app layering that we're used to?
Well, traditional app layering is a great tool to optimize virtualization environments, but we have taken things a step further with MSIX App Attach. We've made core changes to the Windows operating system to support dynamic delivery of MSIX packages. Now, this is a new app delivery standard, and you can use your existing XEs or MSIs and package them up in this MSIX format.
Right.
And if your app is already in an MSIX format, you're ready to go today.
All right, so it's really going to help the admin experience by reducing the number of images, the image size, keeping the OS and apps up to date because it's kind of decoupled from the apps themselves. And for the user, it felt like a personal desktop with local profile and local apps because all those things will attach at login. No change in user behavior for both files and for apps. This is going to show up in the start menu and feel like a physical desktop. But you mentioned earlier that you're storing those MSIX packages onto FileShare. So are we making any updates in terms of storage solutions available to WVD?
Yes, one of the options is to use Azure Files, which is a great storage option. And we're excited to announce today that coming soon, you'll be able to use your on-prem, your native AD controller with Azure Files. This is a really big deal for virtualization deployments.
Right, so you don't have to use AADDS.
That's right. You can actually use your on-prem AD now and associate that with your Azure File storage.
Very cool.
In our demo environment, we've actually set up two file shares on our storage account. One is hosting the user profiles, and one is hosting the MSIX app packages. So switch back to my machine. I'll show you quickly here. I've pinned this this Azure Files instance on my dashboard. I'll drill in here. And if I click on the file shares here, you'll see that I've got two file shares, one set up to host the FS Logic profiles.
Right.
And I've set a quota of 1 terabyte of storage. Now, I'm only charged for what I'm actually using here. This is just a way to manage the storage
admin. Pay as you use, basically.
Exactly. So the second folder has the MSIX packages. So if I drill into that, you can see I've got a bunch of pre-configured MSIX apps in here. And one instance of these applications could be used to host hundreds, if not thousands, of users.
Right.
So think of that storage, or replay it over 1,000, you know, C drives, where you're not using up all that 1.2
gig. And it can all just attach to that file share effectively.
That's right. And we're just streaming them using a highly efficient new read-only streaming solution that's much faster than the traditional streaming solutions.
Very cool. So it's fully managed file share. You only pay for what you use. But I wanted to switch gears and talk about some of the work that we're doing to make remote meetings and Teams better, because I'm actually ready to kind of show some of this stuff, because it's pretty cool in terms of, you know, how it would be if you've got two VMs and you've got to kind of remote up to those and then connect across. There's a lot of latency potential, all these things. It gets better, right?
Yeah, unified communications apps like Teams haven't traditionally worked well in virtualization environments. But we are in development of a solution for WVD to address that challenge and significantly improve the experience and performance of Teams.
Okay.
So do you want to take an early look at the experience and take a look at this?
I think everybody does. You guys want to see some Teams optimization?
So Jeremy, it looks like your camera's on. I think we've already got a screen going here. Let's take a peek and see what that looks like here.
All right.
So look at the quality of that video, Jeremy. Go ahead and wave your hand in front of your camera here, and let's see what that looks like.
All right, just to show there's no latency, no tricks up on my sleeve.
Probably should be.
Here we are. Look at that. Almost perfect. It's kind of going over West US too and back to you and all of these things.
Yeah, so the actual VM that's hosting this workload is actually in West US. You would imagine the latency we'd incur if we were routing that stream all the way up to West US and all the way back.
All right, so what kind of magic did you do to make all of this stuff work?
So in an environment without AV redirection, you're sending these audio and video streams up into the cloud, and they're getting encoded and decoded, which is a very CPU intensive and adds a lot of latency. Now, that reduces the quality and performance of your video. And that CPU encoding and decoding could affect other users on that virtual machine as well.
Right.
But with AV redirection for Teams, we've essentially redirect the Teams AV traffic to bypass that WVD virtual machine in the cloud and send that audio and video call client device from one to the other.
So pretty much it's like a direct connection between your machine and my machine, almost like they're on the same subnet.
Yeah, in this example, well, basically it's like there's a connection between our two laptops here.
Not too bad. This is all done with WebRTC?
Yeah, this is done with WebRTC, and it just creates this direct channel between the two machines.
Cool. So it's a much more efficient way to pass that video feed in this case. But we've done a lot of work here in the clients in terms of the Teams client, but I know you've done a lot of work on the RDS client as well.
Yeah, good segue there, Jeremy. Let me take a give you a quick demonstration of the new RDS client and WVD client for Windows. So one of the things you'll first notice here is that we're in dark mode, much like this whole Ignite event is in dark mode.
Yes.
And I'll show you here under the settings tab here, I can switch between light and dark mode, or just let it follow the system settings.
Right.
So that's one of my favorite features here. I love dark mode. But one of my other favorite features now is I can drill into one of the VMs that's hosted by my IT admin.
Okay.
And if I right click on this and click on settings, now I've got a whole bunch of overrides I can do. So my IT admin would configure, you know, the machine back in the when they create the host pool for parameters like does it support multimon, some of the redirection policies. Well, some of those I can override on my machine here. So I could just take the default settings or turn that off and come in here and say, look, I want this to span all of my monitors. So if I've got multimon, span across all of them.
Okay.
I can start it in full screen. I can have it update the resolution on the resize, or I can actually hard code a specific resolution here. So I could drill into any particular resolution I wanted to start that VM in. So actually, let me show you a quick demo of that. So I'll go into one of these VMs here, this one in particular. And if I just take it out of full screen mode, you'll notice on the host, it simply resets the resolution to the resolution of the window. So as I drag this window open now, get my cursor on it, it'll resize to the new resolution.
Nice. So it's going to fit exactly where you want to put it on your desktop, which is super important and better from a user experience perspective. But now we're here in a room full of admins, and I know that this is something that we didn't show when we did our mechanics show on this. So you've updated the admin experience. We've shown redirection. We've shown all these things that you might have seen in the past. But let's see what's new in terms of the admin side of the house for what you're working on with WVD.
Yes, I'm super excited to show this. So we've been making a lot of investments to improve the experience in setting up and managing Windows Virtual Desktop, and there's a number of partners out here on the show floor who've also made a lot of optimizations and create some really unique tools. But having a native solution for deploying and managing WVD in Azure is something that we've been hearing loud and clear from our customers here. So I want to give you guys an early preview of this. So here I am in the Azure dashboard, and you saw I just went in here. And in the blade, you can see there's a new item here for Windows Virtual Desktop. It takes you right here to our hub. Now, our hub surfaces the most common task, which is to go out and create a new host pool.
Right.
But you can also see that we've got links to important documentation to help ensure that you've got things set up correctly.
Okay.
Now, over here on the left, you can see we've got workspaces, host pools, app groups, and users. If you use WVD today, you're familiar with the term tenant. We've just replaced the term with workspaces,
makes
essentially
sense.
The same
yep.
thing. But let's take a look into this. Let's drill into host pools real quick. And I'll show you that I actually have two host pools set up. One of them that's hosting application groups, and another one that's hosting full desktops.
Okay.
So if I drill into one of these host pools here, first off, it'll show me how many virtual machines I have. It'll tell me I've got two application groups with a total of 12 apps. I could look at any active sessions. I could restart the VM. If I wanted to manually add another VM, I could go create the registration key here and manually add a VM. But that wouldn't be very cool. What's cool is going straight into here, click the Add button, and now I can scale out my deployment simply choosing how many more instances of that VM I want, and it'll automatically build the whole thing for me.
Very cool, very cool.
Very cool. So let's take a look at a couple other little features here while we're in here. So let's go look at the app groups that we've got. And here you can see that I've got two app groups, the browsers and the office apps. And let's say I want to add a new user to the browser app group, right? So I'll click on browser. And if I go over here under assignments, I can see who currently has access. So you can see here I've set up my entire family with access to this.
It looks like a lot of Manchesters.
There's a lot of Manchesters in the family nice. Household. But what I don't have is I haven't assigned it to myself.
It's the best gift for, I think, for Christmas, this one.
I'm about ready to give these guys their best gift.
All
I'm
going
to click add. Now, I could go and find my name in this group here, but what if I'm a member of a group?
Okay.
So let's just add the accounting department and say select. And yes, so, I just added a group of users to my WVD app pool.
And by the way, you couldn't have done that even in PowerShell. And as much as we love the PowerShell part, and we had Jeffrey Snover up here yesterday, this is so much easier. And you can add a group instead of a bunch of semicolon delineated usernames and UPNs. Now you just have the one group.
We're not going to put Jeffrey out of work.
Yeah.
PowerShell is still a really important tool, and you can do a lot of automation with PowerShell, but simple tasks like this, it's great to be able to have a UI environment to do that. But let me show you this real-time, by the way.
Yep.
I'm going to click on the web client here, and normally once I make a change, it takes about 5 minutes for that to propagate, but I think our conversation might have given us just enough stall time. If I hit refresh, we'll cross our fingers here, and hopefully you're going to see that I now have access to, drum roll please.
There's
the browsers.
Apps. All right, you got a couple more browsers.
Just that quick,
awesome.
Now I have access to all those browsers.
Very cool. Everybody like that? You can applaud for that. All right. It's awesome. So even if you're not proficient with PowerShell, you can do all this coming up right from the GUI as part of the new admin experience.
Yeah, we'll continue to support all those REST APIs and PowerShell and ARM templates. And like I said, out on the show floor, there's tons of third-party tools that people have built that you can build on top of this. And I see a lot of creative things that people are building to make WVD setup and deployment so much easier.
All right, awesome stuff. So it's really great to see how we're transforming virtual desktop delivery then as part of the improved remote experience with Microsoft Teams. Lots of cool stuff coming, lots of great stuff coming for admins, but where should people go to get started?
Well, we've made it really easy to find information about WVD. You can go to aka.ms/WVD, and there's jumping points of all kinds of documentation from
there. By the way, if you need help getting deployed, we actually published an entire how-to series, 4 parts, where I personally went from zero to fully configuring all of this, documented it all on Microsoft Mechanics. So you're going to want to check that out at aka.ms/WVD playlist. And if you want to get the learning path for that, it's aka.ms/learnWVD. And of course, don't forget to subscribe to Microsoft Mechanics and follow Scott at RDS for you on Twitter. That's about all the time we have for this show. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next time, and goodbye for now.